Hi everyone, welcome to the 7th episode of Virtual Office Hours at iZooto. Today we have a special guest. We have Ankit Oberoi, who is the founder and CEO at iZooto, at PushUp, right? I keep on doing this every day, so I get used to this, right? But yes, thank you so much, Ankit, for joining us today.
Thank you so much, Vivek, and almost making me the CEO of your company. I would have loved that, but great. Thanks for inviting, and I think it's a very interesting topic which we're talking about today. All of us are going through it, so we're literally living this topic. So right. It's all the more interesting to talk about today.
Right. Awesome. Cool. So I'll give a quick background from my side about what you do and what I know that you do. Right. So. Ankit, for all the listeners out there, has built an incredible business around something that drives, 90% of publishers out there, something that drives 90% of their revenue out there, something that drives Google, right? Ankit has built a business around advertising, right? And he's built a business that is very close to advertising. Ankit does advertising directly, but it actually makes... He focuses on making advertising more efficient, right? And he focuses a lot more on the supply side, which is the publishers, right? Ankit, correct me if I'm wrong anywhere.
No, you're absolutely I'm broadly
right. So Ankit runs a company called AdPushUp. AdPushUp helps publishers earn better, earn smarter using digital advertising, right? And Ankit, you have been doing this for what now? Almost 5+ years, isn't that?
Almost 5 years.
Only 5 years. Amazing, right? Amazing. And I'm sure you've never seen something like this. Just like the rest of us.
Even what we saw in 2008-09, I think that was very different from this time, or perhaps, in the businesses. So this is like the first time we're going through this.
Right. True. Now, Ankit, help me understand. You are out there with publishers every single day. You pretty much see every single thing that is happening on their platforms, on their websites, how they're earning, the quality of their revenue, and so on. Right? As somebody who is literally there in the trenches, right? Tell us more about how have things changed at a ground level in the past 1 month, right? I think COVID became really severe at the beginning of March, right? And by March, and obviously, we are now living in a different reality altogether, right? So what do you think has really changed overall?
Great. So I'll start off with probably talking a bit about businesses in general. I mean, what we are seeing, and then also talk a bit about, how are publishers, what sort of trends are we witnessing and how that trend change has happened, as you said, around March. And I think this is, as you said, very unique time. I think once in a lifetime sort of experience for hopefully once in a lifetime, doesn't happen again, experience for all of us. And I think especially a lot of Indian publishers, how they saw that, there was a pre-geo world and a post-geo world. I think globally, this might be termed as a pre-COVID world and a post-COVID world, because of the quantum of the magnitude of the way the things are changing, right?
Yeah, I was on a call yesterday, and somebody mentioned we are in an AC. So there's an AC world and there's a BC world. There's a before COVID world and an after COVID world, right? And I think that those terms will actually become legit. We continue.
Absolutely. And the more we are hearing about it, we're realizing that it's more true. And while I think in the short term right now, it's creating a lot of stressful situations for a lot of businesses, I think we need to realize that these are actually, so a lot of innovation, a lot of creativity, it fosters or, it improves a lot in the presence of, constraints. So while this is our challenging times and stressful conditions, innovation and creativity thrives during these periods. And some of the best businesses globally actually have been built during stressful conditions. We don't even have to look that far, think of an ISRO.
That's true. Yeah.
All these sanctions India had against her, and we came out with, the best global project, projects at a fraction of the, global benchmark costs.
True. Very true. All right. So going back to the topic, you said changes that you are seeing overall as a business and in the ecosystem.
Right, right. So as a business, of course, everything is happening remote. As a company, we have to, you know, we've been forced. I mean, I think we were somewhere there in that remote culture. We've been forced into, you know, adapting it quickly, which is good. I think stressful times also, you know, force adoption in the changing business environment. And I think going past it, we're also seeing some of the benefits because as we're getting adapted to it, we're seeing how much productivity, you know, is improving across the organization. We're seeing, you know, now we'll be able to leverage probably in the future, you know, the best talent worldwide, and we won't have constraints in terms of geographic location, in terms of people. But see, as a business, if we dive right into, you know, what the business impact has been, you know, CPMs, of course, have been down, you know, 30 to 50%, you know, CPMs have declined, which is drastic, right, which is huge. Before this, we were growing at almost 12%, 10 to 12% month on month, if you'd compound. We, in the short term, definitely think there we would probably not be able to sustain that sort of a growth, let alone maintain it. But, you know, on the positive front, page views, at least in our, you know, websites or the network of websites that we operate in, has almost doubled. If you compare the weekly page views, which we were seeing back in the first week of March versus what we're doing now, it's almost doubled, which is huge. But if you look at the breakup of where this is happening, it's primarily gaming. It's primarily, you know, social applications which have picked up a bulk of those page views, and maybe a little bit of media. Media is taking up, like, maybe, you know, picked up by 20-30% in terms of the page views. But irrespective of that, you know, like, the drop in CPMs is massive, which is why it has forced a lot of publishers to relook at their whole strategy, their businesses. You know, especially, you know, how Warren Buffett says is, you know, only when the tide goes out, you know who's been swimming naked, right? So it's forcing people to evaluate their business models, even inside.
Right. Awesome. Okay. So clear dip in clear revenue challenges, foreseeable revenue challenges, right? Insane traction in select categories, right? These are also categories which are being served digitally, of course, right? And they would sort of continue to sort of distraction, hopefully, as more and more people get locked down in different countries, right? Now, help me understand. So you said apart from the classics, right? The social products or the gaming products, right? Let's talk about media, because that's something which is common between you and us as a business, right? How exactly are these businesses currently reacting to this situation? Because we have been in this now for now over two to three weeks, right? Just about enough time for people to see the shock, acknowledge the shock, and at least build a plan of reaction of action on this, right? So what's your take on that? Have you seen people responding to this now proactively?
Oh, yes, absolutely. And I think people are also realizing that it's not ending now. At least the way advertising works is, you know, quarter on quarter. So people are at least, it's finally sinking in that it's not something which, you know, in somebody would say like an over-optimistic scenario end in like 20, 30, 40 days. At least what we're seeing is this will last at least the remainder of Q2 calendar year. Because, you know, that's just how advertising operates, right? So people are now starting to realize that this is not just a short-term thing. It will last them what started in March till the end of June, at least as far as, you know, like budgets are concerned.
And so now, how are publishers reacting to this? What are they doing differently now? What has changed for them?
Yeah, so, since we operate in the business of optimization, you know, publishers have actually surprisingly started listening to us more. You know, we would have so many recommendations with respect to, you know, what they can do to improve their programmatic, very small things like how they, you know, use floor prices, etc. I think some are still starting to learn that, you know, their strategies which they used a while ago would still not work, will not work in this time. But I think at least there is definitely a need with publishers to understand, relook their strategy, understand optimization. And, you know, we, as since we operate in the space, we are getting a lot of inquiries, publishers are reaching out, which where they just want to understand what's going on. You know, while everybody understands that there is a decline in CPMs, revenues are going down, they're trying to understand what they can do to, you know, like reduce the impact on them. You know, in any given good day, programmatic always has more supply than demand, right? But this has been pushed to the limits now. So this has drive for an overall change, you know, people, how they're selling, especially their programmatic. And I think the stress is more also on programmatic, because as far as direct demand is concerned, this has an even larger drop, because you know how budgets are being created now, for especially for Q2, which we've seen with a lot of these publishers and agencies. The drop in direct demand is even more than you know, indirect or programmatic sources. So they are really relooking at their own programmatic strategy and
Got it. So publishers are relooking at their programmatic strategies. They are listening to you more proactively. They're probably not getting hold on to you know, every single education piece out there to sort of learn, you know, brush up their concepts, right, and figure out how not to lose revenue at this point in time.
Right.
Okay. So now again, right, let's just sort of, you know, being the optimist that we are in the hearts of hearts, right? They sort of, you know, try to pan out different scenarios, right? And see what kind of impact can we, will we see on the overall ecosystem, right? Because all said and done, news and media is, you know, it will continue to be the largest category, you know, when it comes to advertising inventory, right? Of course, you know, there is entertainment and gaming, right? But apart from that, news and media is a, it's a massive category out there, right? So now, if a publisher is currently listening to you, right, and if we were to sort of, you know, play out three scenarios, right? Let's say the first one where 30 days and situation improves, boom, right? We're back on the ground. We're back on the air quality index goes back to 250, right? From 60 today, right? Traffic hits the road. People hit the ground. We're back. Sales folks are back in the plane, right? And we are selling as usual, right? What happens in that case, right? That's one. Second, where the situation, where this continues for, let's say, another 3 to 4 months, we all, you know, we do more of these Zoom calls, right? And third one, where, you know, it's a global mayhem, and we're looking at, you know, forget Holi, forget the, you know, forget Republic, forget Independence Day, forget Diwali. You know, we'll just see each other next year, right? So help me figure out, right? What all do you see happening in these three scenarios?
Right. See, as a business, I think all of us should be prepared for all three. Of course, the first one, which you stated, is the easiest of the lot to prepare for. There's really not much, you know, disruption if everything starts going back to normal. But I think in 30 days, but, you know, as we're seeing more of the data coming in and the impact, see, humans adapt slowly, right? And that's the good side and the bad side both, you know. So with all these changes that are happening and the, you know, budget freezes that you're seeing, spend going down, people going into conservation mode, etc. So I think 30 days, while of course that would be the best scenario, I mean, I'd be very happy, you know, meeting you after 30 days and, you know, we'll make a joke about, you know, how we were so stressed out during that time. But, you know, basis the sense of what we're seeing right now, that seems like it's the least likely scenario, I think, at least in my personal opinion, you know, which I've been spanning out. And I think then if that truly becomes a scenario, I think it makes sense to build a strategy for publishers to basically just use this 30-day period to run all the cleaning exercises internally. You know, we've made a checklist for publishers, you know, which we're recommending. And, you know, basically it's good 30 days which they can put in for that and then start preparing for, you know, the revenue going up afterwards and, you know, plan.
Perfect. So a checklist for publishers to do their, you know, cleanups, you know, look at their old backlog, things which they had pushed under the rug and ignored for a long time, right? Okay, so that, while that's the best possible scenario, it's also the least likely scenario as well, right? What happens if this goes on for, let's say, another quarter, as you were originally expected, right? What should be publishers doing in that case? Because 3 to 5 months is a long time to be depressed.
That's right.
So what should publishers be doing in that case?
Yeah, so that's right. And I think that seems like the most likely scenario now as well. So publishers and businesses need to start, you know, working on that, which actually calls for now drastic improvements in terms of, you know, not just improving their programmatic, but also working on their key first principles as a business, right? They need to make sure as a business, they're prepared, you know, for this, looking at not only just the revenue channels, which is programmatic, et cetera, but also working on their cost centers. We know publishers are not one of the most profitable businesses today. A lot of them, especially small, medium publishers, do not operate on massive reserves. So that calls, I think, for more of actually business work as well, you know, in terms of validating their balance sheets, P&Ls, running all the stress tests. But as far as their programmatic is concerned, I think that there is a lot of things which publishers can still do. You would start seeing that, you know, in fact, one of the things which we're seeing now is, you know, publishers are figuring out what can they do, how can they leverage, you know, external technologies, because if, you know, things go bad for 3 to 5 months, maintaining internal tech is very expensive for them, right? In a lot of cases. Publishers will have to start looking at how can they leverage and bring in more demand and competition. A lot of times, you know, publishers build long-term strategies, which they'll have to put on pause as well. You know, for example, programmatic direct, programmatic guaranteed. A lot of publishers said, oh, we won't even sell things in the open market, right? It's all for our direct deals, etc. So I think we'll have to put a slight break there. We'll have to revise that strategy for some other time. You know, we can, of course, resume it later. But I think at least for the 3 to 5 months, we'll have to start ensuring that we're leveraging the benefits of, you know, the open market competition. We're starting to use external technologies for optimizing CPMs wherever possible. And I think, like I was telling you, in a good normal day, you know, there's always more supply than demand, right? So what this also means is relooking your, you know, ad layout strategy. So, you know, that ad slot at the bottom of every article that pulls in low viewability scores and, you know, over underwhelming CPMs, maybe you walk by. So I think making changes like this would be relevant now. You know, your buyers will appreciate it and you'll be happy that you executed it quickly, right? So I think that you need publishers in that midterm to really build that model and, you know, make sure that strategy is working for the next 3 to 5 months.
Got it. And what if you're looking at a long winter?
Oh, that's when things
get... The worst case scenario. Because I'm already hearing right now. In fact, I came across, I followed Neiman Lab. It's a beautiful publication which talks about print news and how they're surviving, right? And it spoke about how print houses, print media houses, which had survived the World War, which had survived, you know, the slump of 2008, right, vanished in as little as 3 to 4 weeks. They had to shut down their businesses. They literally evaporated from the face of earth, right? And this is, you know, print and media houses, and I'm sure, you know, the print industry will be hit far more. You know, then the digital one, of course, right? Digital is at least slightly more cost effective, right? So, because, you know, while some categories might, you know, jump back in 3 months or 4 months or 5 months, right? Some categories, because of the nature of the category itself, will take way more time, right? For example, let's say events, right? Blog, you know, publications which are talking about events. I guess you're on mute, I think.
Might not even survive that long, you know, like some of these categories might not even survive for that long.
Right, yeah. So, insane amount of stress there, you know, which sort of, you know, goes back to literally, you know, saying that will my business survive in next 6 months to 9 months? So, in that case, so, and especially to those small and mid-sized publishers, right, you know, what would be your word of advice right now at this stage?
Yeah, see, if it's a long winter, you know, we need to be prepared for drastic CPMs, but, you know, they're somebody how a lot of ad tech businesses are built on something like what we had in the housing crash, you know, where these 90-day payments are being settled to publishers at a, you know, like a smaller duration. I think apart from Google, you might have a risk of a lot of falling out as well. right? If,
yeah, true.
So that means even that the revenue that you have already booked, you know, you might not get back. So
yeah.
That such a long duration, you know, the collections will go down. So even when revenue you booked, accounted for, basis which you already paid your expenses, you forecasted your, you know, expenses, etc. If that goes down, you know, that's when things will really be bad. And I think if things look for, you know, like if the things look in a very pessimistic way, if you think about that and go beyond, let's say, 6 months or 5 months, you know, very likelihood that something like this might happen. So which
means, got it.
You know, the moment, you know, we realize something like this, you know, we get more confidence on that. Publishers need to really, then I think it's not just programmatic or, you know, ad revenues. They need to really look at in their, into their fundamentals of how this business works, which is their cash flow, not even their P&L, because like I said, even at the P&L level, things, collections might not come in, right? So I think people will have to start conserving a lot of cash. Will, you know, as they say, cash becomes king in such situations.
Yeah,
so I
think true.
Financial crisis than anything else, and you know, in such situations, all that publishers need to do basically is focus on surviving. Forget growth. Forget programmatic. Even that you know, like reduce whatever you can in terms of figure out what are the most inefficient channels you've been focusing on. You know, take them all out.
Got it.
But that would, of course, be the most stressful situation for the whole economy, not just publishers.
Sure. Okay, guys. Just for the record, I have one last question for Ankit, and then we'll be ready to take questions, right? Ankit, the last one for you, right? This is simply because we've gone through a drastic change in our operating style as individuals, as organizations, as businesses, as people. There are some things that would not go back to the old way of living. Right, to the old way of operating, right? For some, it might be work from home. For some, it might be, you know, cooking. For some, it might be, you know, no more maids. I'm really happy with my own hands, right? But what do you think changing will change for good in this case, post-COVID? What are those few things which are at a fundamental risk of existence, right? It could be trends, behaviors, technologies, people, I don't know. Yeah.
So I think it also depends, you know, how long COVID would last, because like you said, you know, if it's an overly optimistic scenario, 30 days in, everything goes back. I think that this duration would not have been long enough to permanent impact for people, right?
True.
It totally depends on how long the situation, the lockdowns or, you know, this continues. If it continues for another 30 to 60 days, I think some companies might go remote. At least the new organizations which are being built, they would understand remote first cultures, will adapt those. A lot more people will probably prefer, you know, like, or be comfortable working from home, joining, you know,
right,
like this, etc. But look at the other extreme. I think, let's say 12 months, you know, this becomes a lockdown for 12 months.
Right.
Other extreme is, I think then the whole business environment will change, right?
Sure.
And, you know, work from home or remote is not an option. That's the only way forward. You will need a lot of knowledge-based repository softwares. You will need remote communication systems. A lot of people who are not comfortable with technology, the you know, the late adapters or late adopters, they would probably be out of business or, you know, probably will not be able to function in this environment. So I think
right,
we already have... I think this is just a push for adoption, depending upon how long the situation lasts. I think we'll see how internet truly comes to its use and you know, how people adopt to it will probably improve. But definitely see a lot more companies becoming remote. A lot of companies will start thinking scale into their foundations.
Right.
And, you know, right. That's definitely how, you know, what I see happening in the post-COVID world.
Right. Interesting. You know what? I love that last bit, which you said that this will be an amazing time to drive adoption, to learn new technologies, right? And those who will not, right, the laggards will not even get a chance this time, right? In the post-COVID world, right, laggards will have a very little chance. In fact, I think it's actually, you know, this probably is a silver lining for, you know, for people like us who operate in the software industry, because it just means more adoption, right? Or as simple as that, right? Okay, we have the first question from Neil. Hi, Neil, you're on unmute now.
Hi, Ankit.
Hey,
Neil. Hey, Ankit, I have two questions for you. One is a very simple one. You spoke of CPMs have already gone down from 30 to 50%. Do you see different trends in US, India, Southeast Asia, and parts of Europe? Or is it standard 30 to 50 across the board?
No, so of course the trends are different in different geos, across, but I think we're seeing more of a decline in countries which have been affected more versus the ones which are not. In India, for example, I think what we're seeing is about 30% so far. I think between 30 to 35% drop in at least the sectors that we operate in. US is actually also about 40%, 35 to 40 in some verticals. In fact, apart from maybe a couple verticals, everybody is negative, ranging from 20 to 30 to 40%. Except for maybe a couple which have actually improved. So I think once you take a deeper look into and slice and dice the data, you'll see different geos are responding separately and differently. But there are drops across the world, that's for sure.
All right. My second question is, in the publisher environment, what do you see as opportunities right now? I know everyone's thinking of surviving, and I know it's a very difficult time for some small, for most of the small publishers. But I'm sure there are opportunities out there as well.
Oh, yes, absolutely. I mean, and that's what we're trying to focus in our conversations with publishers. This is actually, an opportunity for them to change how their business and their model operates, especially in the old businesses, which were transitioning from print or, TV media to OTTs or that's where, they have the major amount of opportunities. Fast track their adoption. They still operate on very expensive models of, how content is created. So the cost of creating content is way higher than what typically, a digital first company will create content at. They don't use technology all that much, So I think it's a great opportunity for them to evolve and start technology for the businesses. They don't understand A/B testing. They don't understand title testing. And I'm not even getting to their ad revenue bit. I'm talking about how their editorial works, right? So I think they're even their content creation, the distribution models are based on historic models or, based on previous learnings, which do not apply to the current world of digital. That needs to be changed. How they look at, building a continuous relationship with their audience, right? For example, what you guys do at iZooto, building their own audiences, even that's something which they need to prioritize. They need to look at other channels, even maybe if they don't have an app strategy or at all for their most loyal users. Right? A lot of opportunities which are, in this time, now that there is less of work to do on maybe expanding the business, direct deals, where they can leverage those resources to improve where their business models of acquisition, distribution, content creation work, especially with respect to adoption of technology.
Thanks for that.
Right. It's it's actually a very interesting point, right? That how this will literally act as a catalyst, right, in the digital transformation world, right? The old media houses, right? I can imagine the family media houses right now literally running around, right? Fast tracking every single decision which they were sitting on top of for months and for months and quarters, right? Things will definitely fast track. Probably publishers will finally start paying for software.
I realize that. And see, they were already very stressed because of whole digital transformation which they were not able to understand.
Right.
All this pressure from Google, the giants of the web, Google and YouTube, etc., eating into their budgets. Yeah. So I think it will possibly there'll be the last push which will either push them push adoption and get them past this challenge and see all the opportunities, or like I said, when the tide goes out, who's been swimming naked. So they'll probably have to rebuild their businesses
or have to shut all over again, right? Yeah, but you know, finally, do you see this might also be a great time for them to consider, you know, extremely hard alternates like paywalls? And I understand, right? A Punjab case, it doesn't have a paywall level content, which is fine, right? But some, do you think it'll also be like, you know, that final nudge for them to, you know, jump off the cliff and say, okay, we need to now go beyond advertising as our only source of revenue? Do you think we are at the moment now?
So I think given, you know, how consumer spend is, I don't, again, but this might differ based on vertical to vertical, but I think while the industry hasn't been able to figure out a model apart from advertising, you know, which
true
so far, this may not be the paywall time because, you know, consumer spend also reduces. So, yeah. You know, like if people aren't spending on basic necessities or maybe, you know, FMCG goods, it's unlikely that they might spend, you know, money on consuming content unless it's very, very high quality or, you know, something.
True.
You know, like they are really dependent upon, which is very few publishers who, you know, maybe in the financial domain, etc., who do. But
yeah.
Apart from that, I think paywalls as a concept overall is still a challenged business model. It hasn't been proven. And even more difficult, you know, to get adoption from the end user.
Right. Yeah, no, absolutely. I agree. Right. It only becomes more difficult.
Yes.
Right. Some of these things become more difficult, right? Content being conceptually commoditized, you know, thanks to the internet. And then the fact that, you know, people, you know, every individual, right, will also focus on conserving cash. Right.
Yeah.
So, yes, you know, this does become...
On the other hand, I think they should be focusing more on creating engaging content, improving their page views per session, you know,
right.
Metrics, if you know, during this time rather.
But Ankit, you know what? That's age-old advice. Nobody listens to that, right? I mean, people have been saying that for donkey years, right? I mean, you know, focus on creating good content, you know, drive more engagement. But that advice usually has fallen on deaf ears, right? I would love to see that, you know, see the time changing on that. But yeah.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think once everything, you know, the sooner it goes back to normal, people who invest into these activities will see far more returns and the compounding impact of such activities or time invested than the other.
Right. Awesome. Guys, we are obviously recording this. Any more questions for Ankit? Right. Feel free to go wild. Ankit started cooking recently. You can ask him about cooking, A/B testing. Okay, Dishant has a question. Dishant, Ankit sits next to you. You know that, right? You're also on unmute now, by the way. Yes, go on. Yeah.
So these days, that's not the case. Anyway, so I was just listening to this conversation wherein he mentioned about good content. But as far as the industry, right now, a lot of people have been blacklisting COVID-related keywords also from the buy side as well. But the publishers are specifically focusing on the content related to COVID. So what are the creative ways that, Ankit, you think people could change their content strategy in such a world where content consumption is around COVID?
Very interesting question.
Absolutely. All the consumption is happening around COVID, as you said. And that's where advertisers are. So I think it's not all advertisers which are blocking. So for example, a lot of publishers of late have built massive traffic around COVID keywords or, you know, the meters or dashboards that they've built, which are garnering like, you know, hundreds of millions of traffic now. So I think I think just because for the sake of, you know, how important right now it is, not just for them as a business, but also their social responsibility for media businesses to talk about the problem that we have the solution. I think they should continue.
Okay. Ankit Oberoi just left the meeting, which is weird because most likely this is the India internet problem, right? Somebody would have stepped onto his internet pipe. But let's see, Ankit should come back. Ankit is back now. Ankit, you're back.
Sorry, I got dropped.
Yeah. No worries, go on, please.
So, you know, publishers should continue supporting that content and building it. There are advertisers, there are supporters who are still, I mean, it probably may not be best for, you know, like companies who don't want to be associated, who want to make sure, you know, their brands are not associated with something like COVID or, you know, in this situation. But I, I think they're still advertisers. The fill rate is definitely lower, but that outweighs the traffic that they're generating on it. The CPM typically for, I was actually reading about it earlier today, depending upon the traffic which you're getting, let's say if you have US visitors, if the topic is to do with COVID or if it has been identified by advertisers as the subject, we'll see like a 30% decline in CPM. So it's not a big drop because it becomes an interesting topic. People are consuming. It's also a social responsibility. So while advertisers are sort of blacklisting, I think the impact of blocking is not that high or does not outweigh the traffic benefit publishers are getting out. So I would actually encourage them to continue contributing or probably building the traffic as long as it fits in their overall strategy.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I know of a publisher who creates content on government jobs, job alerts. They have shifted their strategy to COVID, right? Overnight.
Yeah.
Because the situation needs that.
Yeah. That, to be honest, I'm not too sure about. I'm not the expert there, but it's only time will tell, if that works or not.
Yeah. That's true.
At least media companies should continue to.
Absolutely. Yeah. All right, Dishant, I hope that answered the question. But yes, all said and done, this is also because everybody's seeing a spike in their traffic. This also, remains the best time to invest in building and growing an own audience, right? Something they could, this is literally an opportunity in a crisis moment for everybody who has, who's there right now on the publisher side, right? As stressed they are, as strained their business model is, right? They could not have been more exciting times in general otherwise, right? All right, Ankit, thank you so much. We do not have any more questions from the attendees, but yes, this is officially the longest I have held 20 participants on a webinar. This is my personal record. Thank you so much for this. Right, I'm going to pause the stop the recording now.